Let's look into inference on the slope in simple linear regression. In this video, I'm going to investigate the appropriate formulas, and I look at an example in another video. Recall our simple linear regression model, where y is assumed to have this linear relationship with x, and epsilon is a random error component, representing that the y's have some variability, and they vary about this line. One important notion here is that if beta 1 is actually equal to 0, then this term would drop out, and y would not have a linear relationship with x. Or, a little bit loosely speaking, the value of y would not depend on the value of x. So, investigating the value of beta 1 is an important point for us in a lot of practical situations. Now, beta 1 is a parameter, and we do not know its value, and so we estimate it. And we estimate it with this beta 1 hat. So, beta 1 hat estimates beta 1. Beta 1 hat is a statistic that estimates the parameter beta 1. And we usually use the method of least squares to estimate beta 1. And if we do that, then our beta 1 hat is equal to the sum of products of x and y over the sum of squares for x. And I look at that in much more detail in another video. But for now, we want to use statistical inference procedures to help us say something about the value of beta 1. To do so, we're going to need to know something about the sampling distribution of beta 1 hat. Our usual simple linear regression model assumes that these error terms are independent, normally distributed random variables with constant variance. And under those assumptions, we can say something about the sampling distribution of beta 1 hat. The sample slope beta 1 hat has a mean of beta 1. The expectation of beta 1 hat is beta 1, or in other words, beta 1 hat is an unbiased estimator of beta 1. And it's not too difficult to show that the variance of beta 1 hat is equal to sigma squared over the sums of squares for x. And we also know that under the assumptions of our model, the sampling distribution of beta 1 hat is normal. Bringing these notions together, we know that beta 1 hat is a normally distributed random variable with a mean of beta 1 and a variance equal to sigma squared over the sum of squares for x. Sigma squared is a parameter which represents the true variability of y at any given value of x. And as is usually the case with parameters, we don't know its value, so the first step is going to be estimating sigma squared. We are going to estimate the parameter sigma squared with the statistic s squared. And s squared is going to be the sum of squared residuals divided by n minus 2. Why n minus 2? Well, if we knew the true values, beta naught and beta 1, if we knew these parameter values and used these values to come up with our predicted values, then we would be able to use n in the denominator. But we didn't know these values, and we had to use our data to estimate beta naught and beta 1 with beta naught hat and beta 1 hat. And when we used our data to estimate these two parameters, we lost 2 degrees of freedom along the way. And so we are dividing here by n minus 2. So mathematically, it can be shown that the variance of beta 1 hat is equal to sigma squared over the sum of squares for x. But we're not going to know that sigma squared. We replace this sigma squared with our sample variance, and we take the square root. And that gets us our standard error of beta 1 hat. Fortunately for us, this is going to be given in computer output, so we're not actually going to have to go through and do these calculations by hand. The confidence interval for beta 1 is going to be constructed in a very similar fashion to things we've seen in the past. To come up with a confidence interval for beta 1, we take our best guess of the value of beta 1, which is our sample slope beta 1 hat, and we simply add and subtract the margin of error. And since beta 1 hat is normally distributed, we're going to have a form for that margin of error that is very similar to what we've seen before. The standard error, which is going to be given in computer output, multiplied by this t value. To get that t value, we're going to need the appropriate degrees of freedom. And anytime you're using a t-procedure and you need the degrees of freedom, you should ask yourself, what are the degrees of freedom for the variance that you're using? Here we were using this variance, and we divided by n minus 2 because we estimated these two parameters using our data before calculating our sample variance. And so we had n minus 2 degrees of freedom for our variance. And so the degrees of freedom for our t are simply n minus 2. And we'd go about finding that t-value in the usual ways, using either a t-table or a computer. We very often want to test the null hypothesis that there is no linear relationship between x and y. Remember, our model is that y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1x plus epsilon. And if the true value of beta 1 is actually 0, then this term would drop out and y would not have a linear relationship with x. So this is a very, very common test for us in the real world, testing whether the slope is equal to 0. We could test another value if we so desired. We could test the null hypothesis that beta 1 is equal to 25, say. But that is simply not a question of interest as often as testing the null hypothesis that the slope is equal to 0. And we're going to use our regular t-statistic, our estimator of beta 1, minus the hypothesized value of beta 1 over the standard error of our estimator. And if we wanted to test a different hypothesized value, that beta 1 is equal to 25 or something along those lines, we would simply subtract that hypothesized value in the numerator. But we are typically testing the null hypothesis that the slope is equal to 0. And so our test statistic simply works out to beta 1 hat over the standard error of beta 1 hat. The degrees of freedom, the same for confidence intervals, n minus 2 degrees of freedom in simple linear regression. And I work through an example of inference on the slope in another video.